Blackstone presents Lipstick by Vish Dhamija. This book is read by Deepa Samuel and Fajer Al-Kaisi.
Serial killers don't stop until they are stopped. Vish Dhamija.
La plus belle des ruses du diable est de persuader qui n'existait pas.
Charles Baudelaire, Le Spleen de Paris, 1862.
The finest trick of the devil is to persuade you that it does not exist.
Prelude, 1993. I wish I were Adam or Eve. Then I'd have no parents, at least not earthly ones. My mother never really liked me. I have a feeling that she never wanted me in the first place. I was either a mistake or something forced upon her by my dad and society. Her disgust with me was fairly transparent. Perhaps I reminded her that she wasn't only tied down to a husband, but also to a child.
Leaving a husband was one thing, but leaving your child?
To her, I was a tow rag, and I accepted it as I accepted so many other facts that I learned in the science or geography class. I was 13, and a loner since as far back as I can remember, and contrary to whatever anyone might tell you, I quite enjoyed my solitude. At school, I made every attempt to keep social interaction in check. I was like another small boat on the dull lake on a busy summer's day, watching, listening, observing, but always striving to remain inconspicuous. Being the only child of my parents, there was no sibling interference to impinge on my privacy. Money was never a problem in our household. My mother was a senior finance manager in a pharmaceutical company, and my father, the retail head in a consumer appliances company. Both of them made shed loads of money, but they had little time to appreciate it, save for buying electronics and updating cars, which were more to demonstrate their financial status amongst their peers than anything else. To be honest, they hardly had time for each other, or me. They worked obnoxious hours to put the proverbial food on the table that no one had time to eat anyway. The secret to the success of their marriage was, ironically, their absence from each other's lives. We seldom ate as a family, except on some weekends when either one of them wasn't traveling. The dinners were all the same. They began with the usual drab meal and ended in some pointless argument that one of them would start. During the few meals when the two weren't snapping at each other, they would resort to dropping broad hints about how hard they slogged to provide me with the best education, the best opportunities, the best of everything. Blah, blah, blah. Of course, I appreciated that I didn't have a dearth of toys or comic books or music, but it wasn't just me they were laboring for, were they? They were competing within their own peer groups and climbing their respective career ladders. It was their rat race, and I just happened to be another one of the meaningless trophies they had picked en route. Unfortunately, my school results weren't bad. Hard-working and above average was how the teachers put it. Only partly true, since I hardly worked for it.
Although I still made it into the top quintile.
I didn't need to put in much effort for what they taught us at school, or tested us on, and that left me with a lot of time on my hands. I could have easily topped the class, but I had no intention of granting my parents another feather to flaunt to their friends. Which was a tad unfortunate, because had I been a laggard, I'd have, just might have, received more attention from them, even if for the wrong reasons. Also, I was meticulous to a fault. I didn't break my toys, kept my room clean. I simply did not give them any reason to focus on me. Well, except for the chronic bedwetting, for which, after a lot of screaming, shouting, and threatening on their part, they hauled me off to a doctor. He diagnosed me with nocturnal enuresis. According to the doctor, it was neither a physical ailment nor an emotional trauma. He assumed that there was no way I'd have emotional issues when I was being brought up in such an exemplar family environment. Instead, he labeled it a developmental issue, and we let it pass. Although my mother continued to rant and rave most mornings about my ailment when she fluently cursed my father and me, just how my father shared the blame was something I couldn't figure. Some of my parents' friends thought I was a bit withdrawn, but then any child whose parents engaged in verbal duels no less than thrice a day, like the devil himself prescribed it, would invariably tend towards taciturnity.
Like Calvin had Hobbes.
I too had an imaginary friend. I say imaginary, but he was actually quite real. I talked to him. We played. We did a lot of things together. In time, I realized that this other person who was always alongside me was my alter ego. Mini-me, mad-me, crazy-me, needy-me. I called him nutty-me, since I infinitely preferred nutty to crazy. I'd say one thing and nutty me would contradict me. We'd argue. He was the evil one of the two, a sneaky devil, always pushing the boundaries when I was frightened or trying to make a sensible decision. Being a loner made me a voracious reader, and I rarely toed the line with regard to age-appropriate books. Dad had a penchant for pulp fiction that he picked up on his travels. I relished these more than I did my own books. Most of these contained one or two raunchy scenes, which gave me immense joy, and of which my own books were totally devoid. That, I vividly remember, initiated the discovery of my hitherto latent desires. My mind fizzed with questions, and the body stirred in response to the provocative text. It made me stop and take notice of the subtle changes occurring within my own body. Although I still had no desire to be drawn into the inane and juvenile conversations of my classmates, Nutty Me and I enjoyed watching girls. I was too shy to talk to them, but liked looking at them, especially the slightly older ones,
since their bodies were more in line with the ones detailed in the books.
Nutty Me helped me find opportunities where I could covertly admire their skirts hike up when they bent forward or sat down. Lie in wait by the foot of the staircase that the girls use, recommended Nutty Me. Rummaging through my father's fiction shelves, I found something that rocked my world. A letter addressed to my mother from someone who was apparently her illicit lover and, going by the sordid details, now pined for her sensuous body, and it certainly wasn't my father's handwriting. It appeared that the man who wrote this letter
had had more than one steamy encounter with her to describe in minutiae what made her red hot in bed.
I noted that she indulged in sadomasochism, enjoyed bondage and other kinky perversions. Whatever. Although it was revolting in a sense, much as I tried.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.